I heard that song for the very first time in Doropo, Ivory Coast, Africa. Never heard it before until 2 years ago. And on that particular day, my heart broke for Doropo and the surrounding villages that we would be sharing in over the next 8 days. They sang the song again the next day, and my heart broke for the city of Clovis, city that I love with all of my heart. For those of you who know, man, I am proud to live in Clovis. So proud I tick off some of our Fresno neighbors. But I've loved where I've lived. I've loved where I've grown up. I care about the direction that we go. We sang the song the next day, and I thought about New Hope Church. And you see, I think there are greater things that God wants to do in this world than what we're letting Him do right now. It's one of the reasons for the challenges that we've been in for the last 5 weeks. If we want our city to be different, if we want our state, I was sitting there thinking, I love this town. I hate this state. I love this country. And I thought that wasn't very nice. But if we want something to be different in the city, and if we want something to be different in the state, and if we want something to be different in this nation, we can't point fingers anywhere else. It must start right here. Right here. And I hope that God begins to create, if He hasn't already, a greater sense of passion and desire and hope that it's not too late to make a difference right where we live. I'm glad you're here today. Thanks for coming. Let's go home. If you are, that was just a joke, just in case you didn't know. If you are a first-time guest here at New Hope Church, it is our delight and our honor that you would choose New Hope as your place of worship today. One, air conditioning doesn't cost you anything today, so enjoy it. Number two, it is an honor for you to be here. We'd love to know of your presence. There's some cards in the pew. I'd love for you to fill one out, put it in the offering bag. We make a promise. We're not going to harass you. We're not going to annoy you. But we want to put in your hands some information that's very, very important about what goes on around New Hope Church. Hopefully answer most of your questions. If you'd like a call from us, don't hesitate to indicate that. We'll be happy to do that. But we do our very best not to be an irritant to you in that way. But we'd love to know that you were here. We do have children's ministries going on over in our Jam Center. And in the 1045 service is our junior high and high school program. And speaking of junior high and high school, they all bail out today right after the last service, and they head to Hume Lake Camp, where they'll be for a week. So we hope some real transformation takes place in some of them. One or two of them I've been praying for in particular this week. Yeah. let me highlight a few announcements and then some prayer requests, and we'll get engaged in our worship. We've been selling tickets for a CBMC luncheon that's coming to town the end of September. The CEO and the son of the founder of Hobby Lobby, Mart Green, is coming to town to speak. We had three tables purchased for New Hope. They are sold out, okay? All the tickets are gone. If you say, oh man, I really wanted to go, take one of the cards in the pew in front of you, write your name on it, write Hobby Lobby, write Mark Green, write CBMC Luncheon. Turn those in. At the end of the day, we'll see how many we have. We will check with CBMC tomorrow, see if we can get those spots. Can't guarantee it, but let us know. If you put your name on the card, what you're saying is, if I buy another table, you're coughing up $20. Okay? That's what the card means. You don't have to turn your 20 in, but if you put your name on it and say, I really want a ticket, and we go and get a table, then we'll be calling you, okay? But it should be a great, great day. 2 weeks from today is our Africa 1040i Sunday. Mike Cousineau from 1040i is going to be with us, and that Sunday night, 6 o'clock service right here, so put it on your calendar. We don't do a lot of Sunday night things, but we're doing it that day. We hope that 6 out of the 8 of us who went to the Ivory Coast in Africa in February are going to be here that night. We're going to share our pictures and share parts of our stories with you. Next week, we will pass around a sign-up sheet, so you'll be thinking about it. Pray hard on this. Pray hard, yeah. Pray hard on this. I know, you never hear me say, pray hard. Pray hard about whether you should bring a container of homemade ice cream on Sunday night, August the 23rd, all right? And we'll have sign-up sheets, make sure we have enough, and if we don't, then we'll go buy the cheap stuff at Save Mart, all right? But we'd love to have several gallons of homemade ice cream, because we're going to be talking about Ivory Coast, Africa, when it was 125 degrees and 70% humidity. So we'll want to cool off when that's over, okay? And we're probably not going to have the air on in here that night, just for effect, okay? That's another joke, okay? 2 sign-up sheets coming around. They're on the same clipboard. The top sign-up sheet, first time it's going around. This is regards to Women's Tuesday Night Bible Study that will start on September the 8th. If you've been a regular, you know what to do. If you want to meet other women of the church and want to get engaged into a Bible study, please put your name and information on here, and they will follow up with you on that. I just told my wife how much I deeply loved her, all right? Because I hadn't told her that yet today. Actually, no, I just told her she had a friend who walked in. So, how are you? Good. Don't anybody else turn and look, all right? It's Shelly's friend right now. The second thing on that sign-up sheet that's coming around has been around for a couple of weeks. If you have experienced a loss in your life, Grief Share is a wonderful place for you to go. It is, how many weeks is it now? It's changed. 14 weeks, all right? You will meet for Bible study and support, and it's just, I can't tell you how many people have said it was amazing. In fact, we had a guy here who went through it himself and then became one of the leaders, Rod Stevens, visited our 8 o'clock service. He was a regular around here. He had been a member of our board in the past. As you know, his wife passed away, and after a couple of years, he met another delightful young lady, Cindy Fox. And Shelly and I had the privilege of going over to the coast and marrying them. And as you know, just about 8 weeks ago, Cindy passed away from cancer. And so Rod has been through this twice in a grief share. He testified to it again this morning. He said, those things I learned made a big, big difference. So I would encourage you to sign up. They're offering it 2 times, a morning one and an evening one. So put your name and they'll follow up with you on that. This coming Tuesday is our senior luncheon. There is a very special guest coming. Please read about it in your bulletin, and we would love to have you here for senior luncheon. If you are 55 or older, come and check out the senior luncheon. If you've been before, you know the routine. If it'd be your first time, just come, all right? We'll look forward to seeing you there. Jam's Kid Barbecue, that's also in your bulletin. Read it, but it's this Wednesday night, so get that on your calendar. If you have kids or grandkids from pre-K through 6th grade, it's a kickoff night this Wednesday night. Next Sunday morning, we are going to share communion, and so would love to have you join us for that special time together as a church family. And then, ladies, you've got a very special day coming up. It's in your bulletin. The date is August the 29th, you're going to go to the movies together, all right? You are going to see The War Room, is that correct? And some of us who were at the Global Leadership Summit, we got to see one of the stars, all right, in The War Room, and that was Michael Jr., the comedian who was at the summit. He is just hilarious, but he's one of the stars in The War Room. And just to kind of whet your appetite, we're going to dim the lights, we're going to take down another set of shades, turn your attention towards the screen, and we're going to show you a brief clip of The War Room. So ladies, see if you want to go. So ladies, buy your tickets, and then the following week, take your husbands. Okay? Take your husbands. So Fawn will be out in the pavilion afterwards today, starting next week. Okay. So tickets next week. Let me highlight a few prayer requests. Caroline Weaver's family, we had a memorial service here yesterday for her mom. If you would be in prayer for them, please. My father-in-law, Bill Ladd, will be going down to Turlock this afternoon after the last service. As you know, he's got lung cancer. He's going to start radiation, not as a means of treatment, but as a means of reducing pain. And so just please be in prayer for them as they go through this journey. Orville Little's service is going to be next Saturday at the Clovis Free Will Baptist Church. Be praying for Janet and Glenn from our church. It's her dad and father-in-law. Jackie Hopelian's dad's service will be 2 weeks from yesterday right here at the church. So be remembering them. Jerry Brown sitting right here. That's a praise item, all right? That's a praise item. We prayed for him last Sunday. And they said his heart was so hard, so bad, that there wasn't a thing they could do for him. And then they said, well, if we don't do something, it's not going to be good. And so they did something. They put a stent in, and he's here with us today. Two stents. All right. Two must be better than one. Okay, all right. So, Jerry, it's great to see you today. Shirley Passarella is having some health issues, really bad back pain and other challenges. Please be remembering her. Ricky, most of you know Ricky and Cody from, they're in our 8 o'clock service most of the time. They gave birth, as you'll recall, a couple of years ago, their first birth. They now have a beautiful little boy, but they gave birth to Eleanor. Eleanor was a trisomy 13 baby. We learned a lot about trisomy 13. We'd never heard of it before, and now we know far more than we ever wanted to know about it. And we walked with Ricky and Cody through that, all the way through the birth and the delivery and the 21 hours that Eleanor was blessed to be with them in this world. And this is an example of how God doesn't waste anything in our lives when we trust Him, even at our worst and lowest moments in life. 2 weeks ago, another young couple in our church, Corey and James, I still say young, James, all right, still there, they found out that James's cousin had a pregnancy that is a trisomy 13 baby. And when they found that out, God brought to their attention, what's the likelihood we would know two people in our lifetime who would go through that? And so they contacted Ricky, and Ricky was willing to meet with their cousin, and they did, and they've been in contact, and their cousin gave birth to that baby yesterday, and it died in a matter of minutes from its birth. Ricky's been in touch with them. She updated me today. She will continue to follow up. So I want you to be in prayer with both of those families, because Ricky and Cody are reliving it, but they are doing it by the grace of God for the help of someone else. See, it's one thing to say, I'm praying for you. I have no idea what you're going through. It's an entirely different thing to say, I understand exactly what you're going through. I'm praying for you, and I will walk with you through this. And Cody and Ricky said they would do that. So continue to pray for them. Would you join with me as we pray? We're going to ask our ushers to come forward after prayer. We'll have our morning tithes and offering and get engaged with the rest of our worship. Father, there are things about this world that probably all of us could say we hate. There's pain and struggle. There is suffering. There are hardships. There are challenges. But Father, for those of us who've spent any time in your word at all, none of those things should catch us by surprise. They may catch us off guard, but they don't have to catch us by surprise. Because your word says that in this world, as long as we are here on planet Earth, even as children of God, there will be trouble. But you ought to also tell us you have overcome the world. You also tell us that you will abide with us, you are living within us, and that in our weakness your strength will be made strong. You tell us that in our infirmities your light will shine not only into our life, but it will shine through our lives and through our afflictions, and it will make a difference in the lives of others. And Father, you are giving us a living testimony of that very truth in the life of Ricky and Cody and their newfound friends. And so, Father, I pray in that circumstances, as well as all of our other prayer requests that we've already mentioned today, that we can abide and trust and confidence in you to meet those needs. Father, there may be some man or woman, a couple, a family who's come here today for the very first time. They're not even sure why they're here, but something drew them to a place of worship today. And I hope when they walk out of here, they walk out of here not impressed with the friendliness of our people, though I hope that was true. And I hope they don't walk out of here with the idea that, man, their music rocks, though I hope they like it. I hope they don't walk out of here saying, wow, that is the greatest preacher I've ever heard. And God, we know that won't be true. But Father, I pray that when they walk out of here, they walk out of here with saying, wow, God was in this place. And God spoke to my heart. And by the grace of God, I'm going to let Him make a difference in my life. And so that is our prayer this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you're visiting with us today, nothing looks weird. If this is your first time here, you say, what in the world is Tim doing? Actually, I have absolutely no idea. We're just going to do something a little bit different today. This sermon has troubled me all week. Probably ever since Wednesday, it said, Tim, this is not so much about the delivery as it is about what you have to deliver. So take yourself out of the picture as much as you possibly can. Today it's about my truth. You see, for the last 5 weeks, and I'll be honest, the preaching the last 5 weeks has probably been the five darkest weeks of preaching back to back to back I've ever done. Didn't start out that way, and the intent is not for us to find ourselves in darkness, but it is in the midst of a very dark world that we're a part of for us, one, to recognize the light, number two, to accept the light, number three, to become facilitators of the light in this midst of darkness. It started 5 weeks ago on the birthday of our nation. When I look to the scriptures in light of current events that are going on, a Supreme Court decision, entertainment movies that were coming out, and historical changes that were being made, and I look to a scripture that I'd memorized when I was just a kid where God gave to Solomon the direction for how to revive a nation. When God gave to Solomon, as king of the nation of Israel, He said, if you want your nation to be different, if you want your nation to thrive and be blessed, here's the recipe. And God said to Solomon, if my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves, will repent of their sins, will seek my face, I will hear from heaven, I will answer their prayers, and I will heal their land. It starts with us. It doesn't start with us pointing fingers at anybody else. It starts first and foremost with us. And it never gets to a point of pointing fingers to anybody else. It ends up with us praying for everybody else. That sermon led me to say, okay, we need to spend a few weeks maybe looking at what are the causes for the trouble that we find ourselves in society, in the world that we find ourselves in. And so we began to look at this theme called Twisted and Unseen. And we looked the first week at All Is Not As It Seems, and we discovered that in this world there is an unseen influence that is functional. And when we start to talk like this, people start going, I wish I could. That's the Batman song. That's not the one I wanted. You know, there was one of them out there I wanted. Anyway, but we don't like to talk about that in 21st century, and yet what we looked at that week is Jesus Himself in a public sermon. Jesus says there is functional in this world. There is functional on planet Earth, an unseen force, and I'm going to identify him for you. And Jesus calls him by name, and he said his name is the devil. And right now, this world is his domain, and he has dominion here, and you will not see him. He's not going to dress up in a Halloween costume with a pitchfork and a pointy tail and horns. As Johanna Michelson wrote in a book in the late 70s or early 80s about the devil and demonic forces, and she titled the book, The Beautiful Side of Evil. And Satan doesn't say, hey, I'm Satan, follow me. Satan suggests things in our thought life. He puts temptations in front of us that are so subtle they don't look like temptation to us. You and I need to face the fact there is that influence in this world, and we cannot do battle with that which is twisted and unseen with natural resources. With that in mind, the next week we looked at, okay, who's in charge of this world? Who's giving us direction in our life? What authority are we making our decisions on? And we kind of took us back to when we were kids on a playground and somebody would tell us what to do and we would say, says who, make me. And how often do we do that to God? And so we try to do battle with that which is twisted and unseen, and we do it with a bit of self-confidence. We don't need God to deal with life. We then, I looked for a mug. I had one and I didn't know it was there. I'm a Texas Ranger. See, it's got my name on the mug. All right, it's good. Actually, I just did that because so many of you bring your coffee in from the coffee cart and I have to stare at you drinking coffee while I preach. So I thought I would do it back to you today. It's actually cold now, so it's never good. The following week, 2 weeks ago, we looked at facing forward. And what we attempt to do is in this world that's filled with so much suffering, so many difficult, unanswerable problems. I mean, why in the world are babies born with trisomy 13? Why in the world is there cancer? Why in the world are there so many people in prison? And we always try to connect a lot of small dots in our life, trying to make sense of it, and we even do that as Christians. And what we attempted to do that day was connect not all the small dots, but the three big dots. Do you remember that outline? If anyone sticks, that ought to be one that sticks. Do you remember the three big dots? Two of you remember. Great. All right. In the beginning, in the meantime, in the end. And when you and I know the end, it enables us to live through the meantime and enables us to process what happened in the beginning. And then last week, we looked at the sticky, delicate subject of sex. If you say it boldly and loudly, it just goes better. We looked at the twist. Okay, we looked at the twist in this arena. And the twist in our culture is, hey guys, sex is only physical. It's just a physical thing. So since it's only physical, there's no boundaries because this thing doesn't impact us mentally. It doesn't impact us emotionally. It has no influence in our spiritual life. This is purely a physical issue. So why can't we define what is appropriate and what's not? We don't need anybody, God, church, government, telling us. And yet, the inventor of the subject, the designer of the action, says, I've created a very beautiful, wonderful, marvelous thing. And in the context of marriage between a husband and a wife, it is beautiful. Anything outside of those boundaries lead to trouble. That brings us to today. Here's the bad news and the good news. The bad news is you're going to get the rest of this sermon next Sunday. The good news is I figured that out in 8 o'clock service, so you'll get out on time today. One day God was looking down at earth, and he saw all the evil and the trouble that was going on. He decided he needed to send an angel down and check things out a bit more closely. So he called one of his brightest and his best, and he sent them down to check things out. When the angel returned to God, they told him, God, it is bad on earth. 95% is bad. 5% is good. God thought about that for a moment, and God said, maybe I need a second opinion. And so he sent another angel to investigate. And this other angel returned to God and said, God, you know what? I'm here to absolutely confirm 95% of the world is bad. 5% is good. And God said, that is not good. And so God decided to send an email to the 5% that were good. He wanted to encourage them. He wanted to give them something to keep them going. And do you know what that email said? Oh, you didn't get it either? Okay, that's the lightest moment in the sermon today, so let's go on. Today we're going to investigate why we didn't get the email. You see, the twist is the devil has convinced us in 21st century society that there's no longer such a thing as sin. You see, it's just a mistake. It's just a mistake. You see, that three-letter word, sin, it's so pesky, isn't it? We don't use it much anymore in daily. In fact, the only time we ever use it's in church, huh? Can you think back of a time this week you used the word sin in a conversation with anybody? Probably not. When my boys were living at home and they would do something wrong, I didn't say, son, you sinned. Imagine how weird it would be at work if you turned a report in late, or you showed up late for the job, or you lost something, you messed up, and your boss calls you in and says, you've sinned. You would look at him weird. Or you get pulled over for speeding or running a red light. Has the officer ever pulled you over and said, you sinned? No. You didn't pay your taxes and you get a letter from the IRS? Might be quite lengthy, might even use a variety of large words that you don't understand. I guarantee you not one of those words was sin. Not once. You see, when we throw out the word sin, you cannot help but think of God. When you think of sin, it is hard not to think of God. You see, sin makes me think of judgment and a need for forgiveness, and that takes me right to God. Or probably, if there is such a thing as sin, then I've got to be punished. And I don't want to think about that. In fact, before we even look at the Bible, I'm not ignoring the Bible yet. Before we even go to the Bible, if you want to Google this, go ahead while I'm talking about it. If you want to look up the dictionary definition of sin, I don't even need to go to the Scripture, but what it challenges us to think about God. Let me read to you the simple definition that I Googled and found in the dictionary. Here's what it says. Sin is a transgression, and this next phrase is interesting. Sin is a transgression of divine law. That's in the dictionary. It's not even the Bible. Okay? That's why I probably didn't tell my kids when they broke my rules of the house, you've sinned against me. Because they know for sure that I'm not divine. See, it's a transgression of divine law, which means there is a divine, it presupposes that there's a divine person. The dictionary presupposes there is a God. Any act regarded as such a transgression, especially, here it is, the secondary definition is a willful or deliberate violation of some moral principle. What's the boundaries for a moral principle? It is a moral God. So sin means, this is why we don't like it anymore, sin means I did it on purpose. Sin means it was willful, it was premeditated. Sin means I knew it was wrong when I did it, and it doesn't make me feel very good about myself. In fact, if I have sinned, after a while, I begin to think, I'm a bad person. And we don't want to think we're a bad person. And we don't want to think our sister, well, maybe we want to think our sister's a bad person, but we don't want to think our mother is a, I won't use that in the next service. I know, that's why I'm not going to use it in the next service. But we can't think that my favorite aunt, Fern, is a bad person. I can't think that my mom or my dad is a bad person. So what do? We don't like this word. So we say, I didn't sin. I just made a mistake. In fact, let me read you the definition of mistake. Not out of the Bible, but out of the dictionary. A mistake, you got to love this. A mistake is an error in action, calculation, opinion, or judgment. And check this out. It is caused by poor reasoning. I just wasn't thinking straight. You see, it's really hard for me to stay seated. I just wasn't thinking straight. How careless of me. I never did see that. That's insufficient knowledge. Well, I just didn't know any better. See, isn't that a lot better word? Because when you catch me sinning, I could say, oh, my bad. My mistake. Or, okay. So I made a mistake. Is that really the end of the world? Or how about this? Look, I made a mistake, but nobody's perfect. I'm not, you're not, I made a mistake. The assumption is you can't get too mad at me because it was a mistake. I really didn't know any better. I wasn't paying close enough attention. Maybe I took my eye off the ball for just a minute. I didn't know everything I needed to know. Could you give me a break? None of us are perfect. A mistake isn't a much better word. But there's a big difference between a mistake and a sin. I want to make sure we get this straight because it'll drive you crazy if I don't. You see, there must be a God in order to sin. And if you feel guilty about sinning, that tells you there is a God. This is not connected to our relationship with each other. This is connected to our relationship with the Creator of the universe. You see, this means I might need to be punished for something. This means I really might have to be accountable for what I do. This is, wait a minute. I like a mistake because you don't need to punish me for this. Because after all, a mistake is not punishable. Let's say I was at your house and I knocked off your mantle a vase. You know the difference between a vase and a vase, right? Yeah, the price, okay? So at your house, it would be a vase. At our house, it's a vase, okay? So I knocked a vase off of your mantle. I made a mistake. I will reimburse you for the vase. But I don't need punishment. It was a mistake. I shouldn't have to pay triple the amount. This is restitution. This isn't punishment. So let's take every possible, imaginable, bad thing that we can do and let's dumb it down to just a mistake. Oh, I've got a better answer. Let's just break this down into every segment of our life, whatever the issue is. And let's just say, I can't help myself. I was born this way. I was born to be a drunk. I was born to be an addict. I was born to mess around. I was born a liar. You know, my dad, this is not about my dad. He's here. You know, my dad, he's a liar. I grew up with lies all the time. I couldn't help being a liar. You know what? My mom, my dad, they abused me. I couldn't help but being abused. I was born this way. And so instead of dealing with issues from the perspective of a moral law created by a divine being, we reduce his principles down and we say, I just made a mistake. Okay, so you caught me with him or her. Can we just go on with our marriage? It was just a mistake. Oh, okay. Okay, I defrauded the IRS with my tax return. It's okay, I'll pay the penalty. Can we just go on? There's a big difference between a sin and a mistake. Mistake, I don't have to ask you to forgive me. I could just say, I'm sorry, okay, let's go. Sin, that's a different thing altogether. Here's the biggest difference, though, and here's the twist from this invisible world. You see, if everything I do wrong can be dumbed down to where it's just a mistake, then what does that make you and me? We're mistakers. Which means I don't sin. And if I don't have sin, then I'm not a sinner. Don't you like this? I'm a mistaker. If I'm not a sinner, then I don't need a Savior. You see, if you're a mistaker, then all you need is just to do better. All you need to do is just try harder. Mistakers just have to break a few little nasty habits and they'll be okay. Mistakers just have to be a little more consistent. They just got to try harder the next time. Let me ask you mistakers a question. This is noisy. How's that working for you? Is it really working, trying harder? Are you really getting better with those little nasty habits? Is your life really different? How are you dealing? You see, if you're a mistaker, you don't have guilt nor shame. How are you doing in the guilt and shame business today? You see, but if I'm a sinner, then that seems to be more fundamental to who I am. If I'm a sinner, then simply trying harder isn't going to get the job done. Because if I'm a sinner, then I probably owe somebody something that I can't afford to pay. If I've stolen from God His character, I can never pay it back. That's a mistake I can't pay for. If I steal someone's virginity, I can't pay that back. Those aren't mistakes. Those are sins. So the twist that we live in our culture and in our world and with the issues that we deal with when it comes to guilt is, I don't want to have sin. I don't want sin in my world. Because if I acknowledge it's there, then I'm a sinner. And that means I need a Savior. And I'd rather just make mistakes, which makes me a mistaker, which means I don't need God. I just need to be better. Here's the problem in all that, though, folks. We know ourselves. The problem is we know better. I might be able to convince you that, okay, that was a mistake. So let's move on. I might be able to convince you that it's only a mistake. But the truth is, when the lights are off, when the music's been turned down, when the television is in the other room, and you're looking at yourself in the mirror, you know yourself better than that. And you know it wasn't a mistake. You just didn't think you would get caught. Not only did you do it on purpose, but more than likely, you did it before. And more than likely, you're thinking about the next time you can do it again. You were just able to pass it off and say, let's go on, let's move on. Hey, it wasn't really intentional. It was just a bad calculation. It was poor reasoning. It wasn't careless. It was insufficient knowledge. But we know in our hearts exactly what we were up to. You knew exactly what you were doing the last time you did it. It wasn't a mistake. It was way, way deeper. And there's something else that makes this hard for us to hide. That's all the internal stuff. Because see, mistakes are what you do out in the world. But what about the internal stuff that nobody else sees? What about the stuff that you don't get caught doing? What do you mean? Okay, what about jealousy? Okay, ladies, what about another lady at the office who walks by you and you smiled and said, "Hey, you look good in that dress. I hate your guts." Hey, guys, what about at work? The guy on the staff that really was hired after you has a rank lower than yours, and he gets the award you had been working for. And you walk up and shake his hand and you say, "Congratulations." And in your heart, you say, "You rat, you didn't deserve it. I hate you." That's the stuff that goes on inside. Mistake or sin? Hey, what about guilt and shame? You see, we shouldn't have guilt and shame over mistakes. And right now, there's something running through your head that you've had guilt and shame about. It doesn't happen with mistakes. But if there's no sin, then there's no need for a Savior, and I shouldn't have to worry about guilt and shame. Where does guilt and shame come from anyway? You ever thought about that? I've got a few friends who were raised in the Catholic Church. They've said, "Tim, I can tell you where guilt and shame comes from." Okay? Here's good news. I was raised in a Baptist church, and I can tell you where guilt and shame come from. All right, I had the same lessons in a Baptist church they got in the Catholic church. I just didn't get hit on the hands with a ruler. You see, Free Will Baptists were so much into guilt and shame, they gave an altar call at every service. And they didn't stop singing that last song until somebody came forward. And let me tell you how that worked in my life. Sometimes I felt guilty and shameful that nobody went forward. I would go forward. It's the way guilt and shame sometimes works. But in all seriousness, where does guilt and shame come from? It doesn't come from mistakes, folks. It comes from sin. What I want to do for the next few moments, I think I can get this done in time. Okay, close. I want to ask some questions, and I want us to look at a couple of verses. I want us to, first of all, before we look at the verses, consider some perspectives about how do we live life. I want us to think about some matters that I believe are essential and of utmost importance as we live daily life. Here's the first question. How do I, you understand what I mean? You're not saying, "How does Tim?" You're saying, "How do you?" Okay? How do I approach matters like life? That should be important to every one of you because you're here because you're alive. How do I approach truth? How do I approach experience? Does truth evaluate my experience, or do I let experiences determine my truth? How do I deal with relationships? How do I deal with things like death and dying? How do I approach these very essential, important matters? Second question, what is my foundation for living, evaluating, and deciding? Two key ways I think that we, in the Bible, Jesus said it this way, you can build your house on sand or you can build your house on a rock. One is constantly shifting and changing, the other one is stable and solid. What do those foundations look like in the 21st century? I suggest to you they look like one of these two thoughts. The foundation of sand goes like this. I want in my life and in my decision about truth and in my experience and in my relationships and even in my death and my dying, here's what I want. I want what makes me happy. I want what makes me happy. I deserve this. Have you ever heard that or said that? I deserve this. Why? Because it'll make me happy. Here's the problem with that. What makes me happy today is often temporary and fleeting and circumstantial. And what makes me happy today will not be enough to make me happy tomorrow. Or, foundation built on a rock says, I want what brings God pleasure. You see, what brings Him joy is eternal and it is abiding. So the question I'm asking you, as you approach matters like life and truth and experience and relationships, do you ask the question, God, what decision will bring you pleasure? I asked a guy a question a couple of weeks ago. Very, very important matter he's struggling with. In fact, he's already made the decision. And I asked him, before you started this journey to a decision, did you ask God what His thoughts on the matter might be? And the answer I got was, His thoughts didn't matter. And you all go, oh, He said that? Are you living that? Four passages of Scripture. John 3:16. Probably don't need to turn that one. You can say it, can't you? Quote it with me. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him will not perish but have everlasting life. Wow, you guys quoted that so good. You're quick back there. Yeah. We get sometimes so wrapped up in that verse with God gave and I get. We miss a key phrase. We miss, why did God give? God gave His only begotten Son so that we would not what? Perish. What does this presuppose? This presupposes that everybody who doesn't receive the gift perishes. Until you get the gift, you are perishing. Everybody. You could go on in that same chapter. This is a conversation Jesus is having with a Pharisee, a religious guy. And Jesus says to Nicodemus, you must be born again. Nick, you're a good guy, but you are a sinner and you are perishing. The thing that breaks my heart is that I cannot preach anybody's funeral and preach them into heaven. Probably 12 or 1300 funerals in my lifetime. And I can only remember one time a member of a family said to me, my dad did not know the Lord, and I know he's in hell today, and it breaks my heart. Everybody I sit with says, oh, my mom, she was a good woman. My dad was a good man. I know I'll see him again someday. And that's not a time for me to say, hey, they're probably in hell. Because there was no evidence. But you and I, you must understand, God gave His Son. His Son gave His life to do what? To deliver us from perishing. If we weren't going to perish, then God would not have had to have sent His Son. His Son would not have had to have forfeited His life. And you and I could do life. We could live a mistake life. We're just mistakers. But He gave His Son. What was the cause of all this? Well, turn to Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3, just a few more pages to your right. Go past the book of Acts, enter the book of Romans. Wish I could read to you the whole chapter of Romans 3, but we can't. So let's read 21 through 23. Romans chapter 3. And Paul says, but now, so much more before that, but now, but we're going to pick up right there. A righteousness from God that's apart from the law, it's been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. Well, what is this righteousness that's beyond the law? This righteousness is from God, who gave His only begotten Son, and it comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference. No difference in who? Earlier in the chapter, talks about any difference between a Jew or a Gentile. And he talks about, yeah, there are some differences, and he highlighted what those differences were. But when it comes to this point, when it comes to the righteousness of God, there is no difference if you're born a Jew or a Gentile. There is no difference if you are born a citizen of the United States or of Canada or of Mexico or of Germany. There is no difference. You were all, what does it say? For all, read it out loud with me. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All are perishing. The gospel of Jesus Christ is for all. But not all will have everlasting life. It's only some of those who there is no difference in the all of those. It is only the sum of those who choose to believe and be born again that will not perish. Verse 24, we are justified just as if I had never sinned, not because I tried harder, but freely by His grace through redemption that came by Jesus Christ. Flip over a couple of more pages to Romans chapter 6, verses 20 through 23. When you were slaves to sin, let me rephrase that because we don't like the word slaves. When we were servants to sin, when we were committed to sin, you were free from the control of righteousness. What benefit did you reap at that time from the things, listen to this, that you are now ashamed of? Guilt and shame doesn't come to mistakers. It comes to sinners. Those things result in death. Verse 22. But now you've been set free from sin and you've become slaves, servants. You have become committed to God and they benefit you. You reap, and the benefit you reap leads to what? Holiness. Do you see the progression here? You go from being justified as if you had never sinned. And now as a believer in Jesus Christ and you grow and mature to Him, your life becomes more and more holy, not because you try harder or work harder, but because of, by grace, we have the indwelling presence of the Savior who is now our very life functional in us. What's the consequences? For the wages, read it out loud with me, for the wages of sin is what? Death. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. One last passage. Continue going to the right to the book of Galatians. Go past 1 and 2 Corinthians. Go to the book of Galatians, chapter 5, verse 16. Paul says, so I say, live by the Spirit. Remember, Paul has written this to the believers who are members of the fellowship in the church of Galatia. He's writing this to Christians. I say, live by the Spirit, capital S, and you will not gratify the desires of your what? Sinful nature. Not mistaken nature. Sinful nature. In other words, You are a Christian with the Holy Spirit, capital S, living in you, but as a Christian, you can still yield to your sinful nature. Not once and done. Daily choice. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit. And that's where the twist comes in. The evil one will try to tell us, oh no, God thinks it's okay. And the Spirit, which is contrary to the sinful nature, they are in conflict with each other, so that what you do not do, what so that you do not do what you want. But if you are led, if you follow the Spirit, you are not under law. Okay, help me figure this out, Paul. Paul says, be glad to. Verse 19. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious. So quick question for you. Are you acting or are you fruitful? For the acts of the sinful nature are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, and witchcraft. Oh, preacher, I'm good. Those aren't my issues. Okay, hold on. Hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage. Caught a few of you, huh? Selfish ambition. Ooh, just got a few more. Dissensions. Yeah, you had a fight on the way to church. Factions and envy. Drunkenness, orgies. And this is not a complete list. Paul's just given us a sample. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. This is a hard verse for Calvinists and Arminians. I just lost 90% of you, didn't I? Okay. Once saved, always saved. Here's the deal. You and I are not to be sitting in judgment of each other. But if these things listed here, or the things that could be added to the list that are included and the like, if that's your lifestyle, you might need to consider, have you ever been born again? But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, this, and I think more, I don't think this is all there is. There's things like hope and contentment, not in the list. This is a sample. But notice the difference. One is our acts of the sinful nature, intentional choices in your life. The other one is the fruit, the outward flow of an inward life that you had nothing to do with except trusting. Abide. The branch abides in the vine. It is the life that comes through the root, which is Jesus Christ, flows through the vine, which is Christ, into the branch, and the fruit is produced in our life. And did you and I have to work harder, try harder, or do better? No, we just had to abide. These two illustrate the difference between a life whose foundation is God and those whose isn't. Do you pray before you make decisions? Do you pray for God's direction? Do you search the Scriptures looking for His clarity? I mean, a few examples and we'll wrap this up today. Do you go to the Lord in prayer and then search the Scriptures with the question, God, should I rob a bank? God, this person annoys me. Can I shoot him? God, should I go out tonight and get wasted? I had a tough week. God, should I move in my fiance, or should I just sleep around a while till I get this figured out? God, is it okay to cheat on my taxes or my spouse if nobody knows? God, is it okay if I become an addict? Somebody's saying, Tim, these are stupid. Really? How about this? God, should I preach this sermon? If you've been at New Hope very long, you've heard me use this illustration before. These lists are the product of sin, not the source of sin. you want the best definition I've ever been given on sin, it's one Major Thomas gave years ago. Sin is anything done in independence from God. Anything done. Your wedding day, you may have been sinning because the person you married, you made that choice independent of God. I could stand on a Sunday morning like today and I can preach to you, and in the process of declaring the Word of God, I can be sinning through my teeth. Because Jerry Brown made me mad last week when I went in to see him and he didn't even answer me because he was asleep. But how dare he not know that my presence had entered the room? And wake up and talk to me. And I could have worked out a sermon all week that I preached to all of you, but man, it is aimed right between Jerry's eyes. I am doing a spiritual thing and sinning because I prepared and delivered a sermon independent of God. God, should I take this promotion and move my family? Here's the best summary, and with this we'll wrap it up today. The best summary describing the real problem of sin is this. Sin will take you much farther than you ever wanted to go. It will keep you a lot longer than you ever intended to stay. And it will ultimately cost you a lot more than you could ever afford to pay. If during this sermon there has been an uneasiness in your soul, that is not me. That is probably the Spirit of God saying, you need to do business with me today. I love you so very, very much, the Lord says. I want you to confess to me your sin so that our relationship can be unbroken and untethered. You're not to be talking or thinking about anybody else but yourself right now. Maybe you've been coming to church for weeks, months, or years, and all you've been doing is going through the motions. You have never moved from the perishing list to the everlasting list. Why not do that right now? Would you join with me in a prayer? Use your own words or say something similar to this. Lord Jesus. I thought that just by changing some things in my life, by going to church, by dropping a little something in the plate when it comes by reading a daily devotional, that God, I was doing better and that would make me acceptable to you. But Father, I've heard today from your scriptures that if I don't make the necessary steps of being born again, if I don't make the necessary choice of, one, believing in my heart, two, confessing with my mouth the Lord Jesus, if I'm just assuming that I'm better than I used to be, then that makes me good enough for where I want to go, I've discovered today I'm sadly mistaken. And so, Lord Jesus, I invite you to come live within my life. Lord, I just walked into church for the first time. I hadn't been into church in years, and you hit me with this. Oh, God, I want you to come live within my life. Oh, God, as Tim read from Galatians 5, I noticed there are more things true coming from my sinful nature than coming from your Spirit in me. And so, oh, God, I want that to change today. Father, thank you for hearing our prayers. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.